except to say Kopstad. And I hope Inez has said something nice about me when she was introducing me, because I don't know what she said. Well, it's my privilege, my pleasure, to introduce to you the author of the book, Espi Mai, is Stuck Again in Portuguese, by my good friend, Anita Pinto. I have known Anita for most of my life. Anita and I were childhood friends. We grew up in the same, what you would call Bardo, Goan, locality, a place called Mahim in Mumbai. We studied in the same school. We later went to the same college. She was actually my sister's best friend, one of the three best friends. They were a small little gang. And I was very good friend of her sister, Serena, who's here. So we've known each other for a long, long while, played together, did things in school together, college together. And later on, when we married, we both happened to come to Goa eventually, where we stayed in touch, we've remained friends, and I'm sure we will do so for whatever time we have. How do I introduce Anita to you? If I had to introduce, if I was given just one word to introduce Anita, how would I describe her? I would say artistic. Anita has always had a flair for presenting anything. Be it her ideas, be it her writing, be it her home decor, be it the way she bakes something or cooks something, be it the way she talks to you. There's always something above the ordinary in her way of presenting things. She is imaginative and she uses that imagination to put things across. If I was given a chance to give a second introduction to her, I would say that Anita is a good communicator. And when I say good communicator, I don't mean that she talks all the time. In fact, Anita is a very good listener. And to be a good communicator, you must be a good listener. You've got to start by listening to what somebody says and taking off from there. And that's what Anita is. I know because my own children, when they were younger, they would sit and she would visit us, or we would visit them, and she would talk to them. And what children don't tell their mother, they will tell somebody else. So she is able to listen, to draw out, and to build up on it. These two qualities, I won't go into a third and fourth, that's enough, I think. These two qualities took her into the advertising world in her bachelor days in Bombay, where I imagine that she used her imagination to sell the products and make good her advertising career. But later when she came to Goa, she used these very same qualities in another direction, and that was with children. She has worked in different ways with children. I think she started out with training or teaching young kids to elocute. Elocution is not just about saying something, but it requires enormous courage to get up from that seat, up to this place, say your lines, not forget them, deliver them, bow and go back. Whether you win a prize or not, I think everyone who reaches the podium when they are little has won a prize, is a winner. Anita, through her elocution, through the elocution classes, which I think she did maybe privately and also I think in schools, she went on to write two books, elocution pieces for children, which are still in demand today, and which required her to select pieces which children could emote and deliver. You see, very often you have teachers who come to the class, and maybe in a geography lesson, they will talk about the savannas and the meadows, and they will explain it, and they will say in England there is this, and the children don't know what is a meadow. So you've got to use words, you've got to use language which the child can understand and deliver. Apart from writing the elocution books, Anita has also written three books on value education. And through the value education books and through her interaction with children, she has tried to be a friend, a guide, help people, give them the values that she cherishes. Love, friendship, generosity, compassion, fun, mischief, why not? These, life is not about being serious. These are all values which I know Anita cherishes and which she has tried to pass on to the people she is in touch with, and largely through her books, the younger generation. And then Anita went into stories. She has written two books, Tales from Golden Goa, and Espi Mai is Stuck Again. And I'm delighted that Espi Mai is being translated into Portuguese. I know that the books have done very well. I am a trustee of an organization called the Other India Bookstore, where we market alternative literature and we market the entire range of books on Goa. And Anita's books have sold and sold and have been selling. So I'm sure that this book will also do well in Portugal. Because when you have a title like this, Espi Mai is Stuck Again, you're not going to walk away. The first thing that you're going to say is who, why, what. See the imagination in the title. You are going to ask what happened, and that is what would draw you to a book. I thought Espi Mai was the grandmother, but I hear that she is a grand aunt. But Espi Mai is your quintessential grand, whatever, grand aunt, grandmother. You're not very old lady, but the sprightly lady who comes along and who sometimes you say, oh God, she's here again. Sometimes she'll ask you all sorts of questions. Sometimes you want to run away. Sometimes you are happy to see what happens to her and you're sure she's going to fall into a ditch because she doesn't look. Something like that. But she is, everybody has an Espi Mai in their lives and in the family that they know. And so I'm sure Espi Mai is going to do well in Portugal and with those who speak Portuguese as well. Let me conclude with a true anecdote. Not about Anita, but related to her. It was told that one of the greatest violinists in the world, I think, a gentleman called Antonio Paganini, and I hope I have the name right, he was once on stage to play before a grand audience, a violin, he was giving a solo concert. And just before the concert was to begin, he realized that he had not brought his violin, the priceless one which he used for concerts, specially crafted for these occasions. And he didn't know what to do because he was on stage. The stage had opened, he was before the crowd, and here was this gross error. He had another violin. There was nothing he could do. And so he took a deep breath, like you do when you're in a panic, put his violin on his shoulder, and played as best as he could. He tried to bring out the best performance, knowing that perhaps he had a substandard violin. He played to a grand ovation, a thunderous applause. Many people said later, it was the best concert he had ever given. And later, backstage, when people called to congratulate him and spoke to him, he said to somebody around, today I've learned the greatest lesson of my career. I always thought that my music was in my violin. Today I learned that the music is in me. Anita is like that. Put her anywhere in the globe, anywhere on this planet, and she will write a good story. Ladies and gentlemen,